Well, welcome back. It's good for me to be back. I had a week off last week, and I went down to West Virginia, and the leaves were starting to change. I went down on my motorcycle and went with some friends. Shout out to Bill and Steph. We had a great time. And hey, I'm going to have another Ramblin' Rev video for you soon. Won't promise you it's going to be this week, but soon I'm going to get one out, and you can take along, you can ride along with us. But boy, I'm glad you came back. I want to shout out to Dan Jurek for filling in last week, and he's got a lot of great videos online, Dan Jurek's YouTube page. So check them out. He's going through the Bible, and yeah, I think you'll be blessed by them. So anyway, let's get started on this, our continued study of Daniel. And what an incredible book, what an incredible study that you and I have gone on. And if you're new, welcome. We're glad you're here. Don't forget, guys, hit the subscribe button. And then that way, the more views we get, the more. Share it on your Facebook page. And let people know that you're being blessed. Encourage me, encourage them to listen. And I just throw that out there to you. But you know what? The important thing is that you're here today and that we're going to look at the Word of God. So I want to ask you something. What was your favorite class in school? Or what is your favorite class in school, in case you're still in school? For me, it had to be gym, recess, or lunch. But what was your least favorite class in school? And I don't have to list out three of them. My least favorite class was history, world history. And I still have problems trying to find things on the map and understand it. It's probably one of my weakest areas. So if you're following along with our reading plan, which you can pick up on our website, I'll put the website at the bottom. You know that chapter 11, where we are today, is just a line of history. It's very tedious, and it's very long, and it seems like it's back and forth and back and forth, and it is. But I'm hoping to help you with that, because we read things like the king of the north went against the king of the south, and the king of the south retaliated against the king of the north, and the king gave his daughter and then marriage and to make an alliance, but that didn't work out, and it just keeps going back and forth and back and forth. But it's important that we know that, even though it's history. So come along with me. Let's try to study it together. Let's take a look at it together. And Dan's title to his talk last week was, let me tell you what I don't know. Well, and I thought, you know what, my title is going to be, let me tell you what I do know. And in all this mess with the history, it's difficult. But hey, let's take a look at it. But let's pray to the Lord first and ask Him to bless our time together. Won't you pray with me? Father, You are awesome. You are gracious. You are loving towards us. You have provided for us. Lord, You're giving us the very breath to be able to watch the video, to be able to give the video, to be able to do our daily lives. Our breath is from You. Lord, too, the other thing is that you've blessed us with a place to eat, hearing that we can hear, that we can give us eyes that we can see You this morning. We thank You, Lord, for Your grace and Your mercy available through Christ on the cross. Father, this is Your word we're going to look at today. It's called God's Word for a reason. You're the author. And Lord, we need Your Holy Spirit to be working in our lives, to open up our hearts, to help us understand something that was written those thousands of years ago, why that matters to us today. Lord, give me the words to speak and the ears to hear for those who are listening. Lord, may You receive the glory and praise, and we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so kind of picking up from where Dan left off last week, chapter 10 tells us that Daniel had a vision in the third year of Cyrus. That's verse 1 of chapter 10. And we find out that this vision upset him. And he asked for explanation. And God sent him one who looked like a man to explain to him what the vision meant. And so when we start off here, that's the background. So God is sending this one who looked like a man to explain to Daniel what's going on. And if you look in your Bibles in chapter 10, it says, the man says to Daniel, I have come to explain to you, this is verse 14 in chapter 10, now I have come to explain to you what will happen to your people in the future, for the vision concerns a time yet to come. We've been looking at prophecy. What's going to happen? What in the world will happen is our series title for this second half of Daniel. So, let's take a look at it. Verse 21 of chapter 10, and we'll get to 11. But first, I will tell you what is written in the book of truth. You know, my first thought today, the thought that you and I can have, is God is not Dr. Seuss. Now, that may seem weird to you, but you know what? Dr. Seuss wrote fiction, right? I hate to burst your bubble, but there is no Who's in Whoville. And the red fish doesn't have a little star, and the blue fish doesn't have a little car, right? We know that. We know that there's no Who's in Whoville. We understand that that is fiction. That is something to entertain us and so that we enjoy it. And I love reading Dr. Seuss books. In fact, as I thought about that whole thought, that Dr. Seuss, I don't mind reading that, but the history in here in chapter 11 is a struggle for me because I don't connect with it quite as good. And my first point here is that some people view the Bible as nothing more than a book written by man like Dr. Seuss, like the Who's in Whoville. They have problems with the fact that the donkey talked. They have problems with a flood. They have a problem with the sun standing still for a day. How can those things happen? Well, I want you to know that chapter 11 is such a difficult chapter because it is very laborious. It is very detail-oriented. And it either means that this book was written by God prior to these events happening. Someone knew this ahead of time, which would have to be outside of our realm of understanding, or it was written afterwards. It was written, it is so detailed. So I want you to remember that as you go through it this week, is you're going to get to these details, and I hope it reminds you to go, hey, you know what? This is so detailed that either had to know it after, they either had to record it after it happened, or it was recorded before it happened, and it was recorded by God. And we see that it's the book of truth. You see, let me tell you, folks, God did not, this was not written afterwards. God showed us the future here. And in such a way that a couple hundred years before all this happened, Daniel gets this vision and it lays out this period of history. And it is an incredible look. It's so detailed about the events that God is not like Nostradamus. Right? I mean, Nostradamus is like, well, the eagle flew into the big tree, and it's very poetic. And we can look back and we try to fit it in. But this here is so specific. This talks about this ruler giving his wife to this person and that not working out. And they sat down and he went to the north and this all laid out in history. I want you to know that my first point here is God is not Dr. Seuss. God does not write fiction. What everything that God writes is truth. Look at the way it's reinforced here. In verse chapter 1 of chapter 10, it says its message was true. Down in verse 21, it was written in the book of truth. Down in verse 2, I tell you the truth. This is a prefiguring. This is letting us know ahead of time, letting Daniel know ahead of time what's going to happen to his people. And you remember the head, arms, belly, legs, and toes. Remember that video? The head is Babylon, Medes and Persians, belly is Greece. And it starts out, the three more kings will arise in Persia, that's the arms, and then a fourth who will be far richer than all the others. When he has gained power by his wealth, he will stir up everyone against the kingdom of Greece. Remember, Greece in the belly, Greece doesn't sit well. So it's the Medes and Persians, then Greece. And he's saying this is what's going to happen in connection with what we read in chapter 2. And then he will arise, who will rule with great power and do as he pleases. That's Alexander the Great. After he has risen, his empire will be broken up and parceled out toward the four winds of heaven. And you may remember in history, Alexander the Great died at the age of 33, I believe, and from a fever. And his land that he had conquered was split up among his four commanders, his four generals. And that's why it says it's parceled out toward the four winds of heaven, north, south, east, and west. And so it will not go to his descendants, nor will it have the power he exercised, because his empire will be uprooted and given to others. So they didn't rule as powerfully. But there's this north and south battle that goes on here now from verse 5 all the way to verse 19. And the north is the Seleucids. That's where Antiochus comes from, the Seleucids in Syria. The south are the Ptolemies. And the Ptolemies are the empire, the dynasty from Egypt. So that's north and south. And that's why we get this north and south. The south came up, the north came down, the south went up, the north came down, the south went up, the north came down. Back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. The exciting part about that is that this is in such detail that we can easily place the kings in order. And I'm not going to do that for you in the video. It would take way too long. But take a look at it. Ptolemies and the Seleucids. And you will see that it fits right in with what is going on here. So what does this mean to us today? Let's just make an application here. Here's what it means. God knows the future. You know, you and I know the past, right? You know what you did before you turned this video on. You might have known what you did yesterday. You might be a little fuzzy on what you did a week or a month ago, right? But God knows the future better than we know the past. And he's in control. As you're reading this week, look out for the word appointed time. God has this set up. And what I learned was, I don't care about history, but I do care about his story, which is God's story. And we can see how it's playing out. So that causes us to have peace. That causes us to have contentment. That causes us to know that God has a plan and a purpose that he's working out. And it's not just for the Seleucids and the Ptolemies. It's for you and I. It's not just for world leaders. He's got a plan for you and I. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in a second. But every single part of this is God's truth. And it happened exactly like it said it would happen, all the way up to verse 35. And verse 36, which we'll probably look at next week, that section to the end of the chapter, hasn't happened yet. But the rest of this has, right in line with how history has gone. So God is the author of his story. He may not be like Dr. Seuss in the sense that Dr. Seuss writes fiction, but God does not write fiction. He writes nonfiction. He writes truth. This is his story that's playing out in just as he has planned it out. Now, the other thing that we want to, the second thought that I want to look at is the truth is upsetting. You know, when you get a report from the doctor that says you have cancer, that's upsetting. You know, even though if you're a believer and you're trusting God, it's upsetting, right? It's upsetting to look online at your bank account and find out the $1,000 you thought you had in there is gone. You spent it at the ATM, right? The truth can be upsetting. And we see here that Daniel is so upset. Look at verse 2. Dan touched on this last week. At that time, I, Daniel, mourned for 3 weeks. I ate no choice food, no meat or wine touched my lips, and I used no lotions at all until 3 weeks were over. Look at over at verse 16. I am overcome with anguish because of the vision, my Lord, and I feel very weak. So here's Daniel. He's so upset. He eats no choice food or meat or wine touched his lips. He's recognizing this is the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia. And what that means is when we look at our timeline is the people that were exiled into Babylon, now controlled by the Medes and Persians, were allowed to go back to Jerusalem to rebuild the temple. They were allowed to go back. Some have already gone back. And Daniel's probably like, oh man, am I glad this is over. And then he gets this vision that has the north and the south that are fighting back and forth. And sometimes they're taking residence in Israel. They're taking over the beautiful land. That's Israel. You'll read that. And so what I'm saying is Israel's caught in the middle, and they are going to be persecuted, and they are going to have, there's going to be death, and there's going to be struggles, and there's going to be this caught in the middle kind of attitude. And right when Daniel thought, when he was reading, remember the book of Jeremiah, he said, oh, 70 years and this is over and you'll be able to go back and rebuild. That was true. Happened just the way God said it would. But here we see that Daniel is finding out that his nation, his people, aren't done going through it yet. Well, I can't help but think about COVID-19. You know, just when we thought like things were getting back to a bit more normal, and now there's more outbreaks, schools are trying to go, and it's just a very difficult time. And I don't know about you, but I'm kind of discouraged that it's not over. And it seems like it should be over. And now we're getting wave after wave. And I think that's kind of how Daniel was feeling. Daniel was feeling it like, when is this over? One of the worst times for the Jews is explained in verse 21 through 34. You may remember, or 35 actually, you may remember the message where we talked about Antiochus Epiphanes. He was one of the Seleucids from the north in Syria, and he had gone to fight the king of the south. It's in here. And he lost, and on his way back through, he took it out on the Jews. And he set up the pig in the temple. If you remember, he stole the gold and silver from the temple. He killed 80,000 Jews. He made 40,000 of them slaves. And it was the worst time in Jewish history up to this point. And so that's why Daniel's mourning. That's why he's having so much trouble. So what does that mean to you and me? Here's what that means to you and me. To you and me, what that means is that in this world you'll have trouble. Jesus said that, right? It's not easy to live in this world. There's going to be famine. There's going to be difficulties. There's going to be health issues. God does not keep us from them. God does not shelter his people. And sometimes we think he should, right? We should. But here's the reality. Bad things happen to God's people. And so Daniel's reading this and he's so upset. And it's a result of the fact that there's in this world, you will have trouble, Jesus said, right? And we will have difficult times. And I know we don't like to think about that. We don't like to hear that. We don't like to be a part of that, right? We want to have a comfortable, easy life. And God doesn't promise us that. He promises something different. He promises that he'll walk with us. Jesus said, they hated me, they will hate you. As we walk as followers of Christ, it's going to be difficult. And it's going to be hard. But you know what? In Romans chapter 1, it says the world is going to continue to get worse. The evil is going to continue to flourish. Evil is going to continue. And wickedness. And man's heart is so bad. And we need a Savior. We need someone to save us. And so the truth can be upsetting, our world, our politics. But hey, let's go back to why this matters. And let's just talk about what about us for a second. Let's finish it up with what does this have to do with you and me? First of all, history is his story. God is still in charge. You know what? The election, God is in charge. You know what? COVID-19, God is in charge. You know what? The issues that you're struggling with in your life, God is in charge. Not only is he in charge, but God knows what's going on. His plan is coming to fruition. And he has a plan for you and me. And it may not be an easy plan, but it's his story that he's writing out in history, exactly as he had planned it. So it's not out of control. This world is not out of control. God is placing people in rulers and kingdoms, just like he had set before time, according to the book of truth. And it's an incredible thought. But don't trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. So then, secondly, what God's word to me are the same words that the man gave to Daniel in chapter 10. Look at what it says in verse 19. Do not be afraid, you who are highly esteemed. He said, peace, be strong now, be strong. And then it says that when he spoke to me, I was strengthened. God wants to put his hand on you today and tell you to have peace. That peace means wholeness. Be anxious for nothing, but by everything, by prayer and supplication, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You know, God wants us to know that we can have peace in the midst of these storms that we're going through. that he's still in control. He says, do not be afraid. He's in control. That's what we learn in chapter 11. We know that this thing here that God showed us is working out just as he said. So it is, he's still in control. Do not be afraid. You are who are highly esteemed. You know what? God loves his people. God loves you. And he cares about where you are. And as I looked at this and as I studied this week, I wrote something in my journal that I want to share with you. This is what I wrote. His story is right on schedule. The history books record the incredible events that Daniel has made aware of centuries before it happened. God is in control, accomplishing his will for his glory. But this was an extremely difficult time for God's people. God's people are not sheltered from tough times, but they are equipped for difficult times. The hand of Jesus reaches out. And I want you to think about God saying this to you, that Jesus saying to this, take my hand, peace, be strong. Be strong now. I will be with you and never forsake you. Trade your anguish for my peace. Do not be afraid. I know what's going down and I am in control, even if it doesn't look like it. I've got your hand. We will walk together through this. The best is yet to come. Follow me. I've got this. That's God's word to us. The same thing he told Daniel. He says, I know it's upsetting, but look, I'm in control. You are highly esteemed. I love you. Take my peace and you'll be able to get through it. And then this is the truth that brings peace, who Christ is. Isn't that awesome what God shared with me? And so then the final thing I just want to get us to think about is verse 32 of chapter 11. It says, but the people who know their God will firmly resist him, meaning will resist the Antiochus. But the people who know their God will firmly resist him. I like this translation better. In a lot of Bibles, it's translated this way. Those who know their God will be strong and take action. Will be strong and take action. You know, it's time for us to stop wanting the COVID-19 mess to be over. And it's time to start doing what God has laid out for us to do. It's time to be strong in his strength. It's time to get about his business. We see that the history is playing it out, that there is an appointed time of the end, and you and I need to be ready, and you and I need to be found faithful. So why don't you and I draw a line in the sand today and surrender to the Lord and say, God, you know what? Here it is. I'm giving you my life. I'm not gonna be talking about this COVID-19 thing and how it's disrupted my life. I know that you put me here for a purpose in this time, and I want to do what you want me to do. And we can draw a line in the sand, similar to what Daniel did in verse 10, where the one who looked like a man said to him, since the first day you set your mind to gain understanding and humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I have come in response to them. An incredible thought. Let's give our whole heart to the Lord. Let's seek him out during this time. Let's trust him. Let's rely on our good Father who loves us. And he says, take my hand and that we can get through this. And we'll get through this together, Jesus tells us. And there's a future and a hope that God has planned for his people. And so right now, when we're in this world, there's evil and there's troubles and there's trials. But we have a God who walks with us, who knows the future, who's still in control. And so this book of truth tells us that. So why don't we go to the Lord and surrender our hearts to him? Father, we thank you for your word. It is so tedious here, but it tells us that you know every detail. It tells us that you know the future before it happens. It tells us that your plan is still working. And Father, we thank you that you have sent Jesus Christ to die on a cross that we might have eternal life. And Father, all we need to do is surrender our life to you, to draw a line in the sand and tell you that, God, I need a Savior. I'm a sinner, but I want to be on your team. I want to be on the winning side. I want to be a one who loves you and honors you with all my heart. And we just have to admit to Christ that we're a sinner. We just got to ask him to be our Savior. And Father, our president's not going to be our Savior. Our Savior is Jesus. And he's going to take us to a place where there's no more sin and no more tears and no more crying. That's our hope and our future that we're looking forward to. But Lord, while we're on the earth, let us be aware of your presence. Let us seek you out. Let us surrender our lives and our hearts to you, that you might be given the glory and praise through history, which is your story. And Lord, we just ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. It's been great to be with you. If you've made a decision to trust Christ, send me an email at fbchapel@zoominternet.net. The reading plan's available at fbchapel.org. Hey, hit the subscribe button, post it on YouTube, let your friends know. This might be an encouraging thing that they just need to hear right now, that God is still in control, that he's at work, that it's his story that he's writing, and he has a plan for you. I can't wait to see you next time. Thanks for being with me today. And we'll just keep going through Daniel. Don't get discouraged this week. You read the history as it happened, and just as God said. And have a great week.